Zoom, yes, thank you very much. Hello, welcome everybody to a new episode, still in Denmark. Some of the last few days, we're just gonna chill over the next few days. We are a bit tired, but I wanted to make some content about the beaded lizards. Last year I was also here and I made a video about the Gila monsters and the beaded lizards. But I gotta be honest with you, I like the beaded lizards way more, especially the ones that my friend Jesper has here. So we're gonna show you some beaded lizards today. I'm just gonna shoot some video about the setup. It's pretty simple, as you can see in the back. And we're also gonna make some close-ups of them outside. So I think first we're just gonna grab one or two really cool animals, go outside, show them to you, and talk a bit about the beaded lizard, also known as the Heloderma horridum. Oh, and then I need to do like this. It's really YouTube. Bam! Yeah! Now, then first we're gonna start with the Colima. Are you going to grab her or me? So I can feed the camera?
I can do.
Yeah.
Yes, of always put on the glove.
We use on the Hex Armor gloves. Can you show this to me? Hex Armor gloves. Yeah, promoting these. Really safe gloves. They are used for handling big lizards and venomous snakes. They are just really sturdy, and in case they bite, the chance of them penetrating it is pretty small. So it's a safe way. If something goes wrong, you have like this extra barrier. And there's also people using them, for instance, to open cages with venomous lizards. Just in case a venomous lizard or a snake like bites out, then you have an extra safety barrier between your hand and the animal. And you already have it. She's so happy. Yeah. Can you open your mouth? Yeah, thank you very much. As you can see, beaded lizards, of course, like the Gila monsters, yeah, are venomous lizards, but they don't have their venom glands and teeth in the upper part of the jaw, like venomous snake have, but in the lower part of the jaw. So you see this, come on, zoom, yeah, bulge. Keep still, man, keep still. You see this bulge on their lower jaw? Really has a hard time focusing. Yeah, you see this, oh, she's not happy. Underneath there, I need to mind my fingers because they are faster as they look. And that's where their venom gland is. And then they have several enlarged teeth on that lower jaw. And when they bite, they create a big wound. And it's not like they are injecting, like a venomous snake does with these almost hypodermic needles, but more creating a wound. They chew and then the venom is focusing on its legs. It's not what we want to see while you're doing that. That's what we want to see. And yeah, they make a big wound and then the venom just flows inside the wound. So when they grab something, they hold on for a bit. Big tongue.
Video.
Okay. Yeah. Classic threat posture. This is an unhappy horridum.
Lifting him up from the ground and everything.
But as you can see, they really show that they're not happy. So if you get bit, it's your own fault. You come too close, you're just coming way too close. They clearly show they're not happy. Raising its body from the ground, opening its mouth, slowly backing off. Classical Heloderma trap posture. Backing off. And when I get close again, there she goes. Never back off. This is a really big female. Let's take her outside. Look at that. Oh, so nice. Okay, so I'm not really restraining this female because she's acting kinda okay. Still keep a good check on her. And I could restrain her now, but then I would just make her a bit more edgy. So if they are calm, I will be calm. And this is a really big female. She must be 70 centimeters long. 40 centimeters body, 30 centimeters the tail. And yeah, these are just some really cool lizards. You can see why I call them the beaded lizards, because of the
scales upon their head that look like little beads. They have a really rough skin, but their belly is actually quite soft. And the Horridum that have much longer legs than the Gila monsters have, because these climb more. And these animals are located a bit more south than the Gila monsters, and that's why they also don't need a really low temperature hibernation like the Gilas do. And at what temperature do you hibernate these?
Down to 17-20 degrees.
17 and 20 degrees, yeah. That's perfect. So for instance, if you have a reptile room with subtropical animals, you can just turn down all the heating and they will get down to the right temperature, let them hibernate for 2-3 months probably.
Yeah,
2-3 months, and then that's it. So it's, in that case, pretty easy hibernation. You don't really have to drop the temperatures really low or put them in the hibernation box or in the refrigerator. You okay, lady? They are such cool animals. 4 subspecies of this. You have the Heloderma horridum, which is this one. You have the Heloderma horridum exasperatum. That is probably the most common one in captivity, also bred the most. You have the Heloderma horridum alvarezi. There are a few of those in captivity, especially a low amount in Europe, a bit more in the States. And you also have the Heloderma horridum Charles Bogarti, which probably is the most protected of all the 4 subspecies. Is this also a Kolyma or just a Horridum horridum?
That's a Oaxaca.
Oaxaca.
Yeah, they get a little bit bigger and mostly have more black and more yellow-white spots. Mostly
okay,
white
nice.
Spots.
Awesome lizards. Now, in captivity, these animals are pretty easy to keep. They're a bit of a lazy lizard, I have to say. You don't see them do that much. It's also what you see in the wild. Depending on the season, their activity might change. For instance, in the cooler months, they are a bit more active during the day, or at least when the sun comes up or down. But in the hot summer days, of course, they hide in burrows. That's why you also have these claws. And once the temperature drops during the night, that's when they become more active and hunt. You can really see her use that long tongue of hers, and that's what they use pretty much just like a snake to seek out any prey. They love eggs, young birds, but they will also eat snakes, lizards, pretty much whatever comes on their path. In captivity are mostly soil fed with rodents, small mice, small rats, but also eggs and all that kind of stuff. Have you ever fed these guys insects?
No.
No.
Never.
Would they take it, you think?
No idea.
It's a good idea, actually.
I heard someone tried the dubia roaches, but I never tried it. Okay. Mostly feed the rodents and chicken.
Yeah, as you
sometimes
can,
chicken eggs.
It's also logical, because if you look at their build, the way they are shaped and the way they move, it's not really like a hunting lizard, like a varanus or something like that. They're more shaped for opportunistic hunter. They will probably even eat roadkill or stuff like that. Just whatever comes on their way. These guys have a much longer tail than the Gila monsters. It's used for balance during the climbing. And you can see the Alvarezi, which is probably the most arboreal of all the 4 subspecies. They have a much longer tail and even longer paws and claws. So really cool to see within a species, these 4 subspecies, you can really see differences just with the locality form, with their colors and their build and their length. You can also see between the subspecies, yeah, really good differences in tail and other build. It's almost a bit of enrichment for her.
Yeah.
Checking out the grass, using her tongue. Man, they are awesome. This is a little bit different looking than the previous ones we saw. This Oaxaca, also a female. Really inspecting the grass she is walking on. This one has all these small markings. So not the slightly bigger individual spots, but a lot of small speckles. How old is this female, Jesper?
She's from 2016.
Okay, so 3 years old.
Yeah.
That's a great size already at 3 years. Imagine they're over another 3 years. They're gonna be huge.
And she's also a female, so hopefully she will breed next year.
Nice. How many eggs do they lay? As you guys, I'm sorry I'm asking so many questions. I'm doing this trip to learn, so you guys are learning with me. So please tell me, how many eggs do they lay on average? Because you have some clutches of the Gila monsters now.
Yeah, but this is my first year breeding beetle lizards.
Okay.
Hoedom. So I have no experience myself yet, but what I'm told, up to 20, but they can get some bigger clutches also.
That would be expected. They're bigger lizards. The Gila monsters only measure up like 45, 50, sometimes 60 centimeters.
A friend of mine did get a Gila clutch of, I think it was 11.
So 11.
That's pretty big.
That's a big clutch for a Gila monster.
Yeah. The latest I got was 9.
Nice. Still a nice clutch.
Yeah.
And the eggs take pretty long to hatch.
Yeah.
Yeah, how long did your previous clutch take to hatch, and at what temperature?
Last year it took 140 days at 28 degrees.
28 degrees,
yeah. Such a cool movement.
They're really good climbers. You wouldn't expect that as you look at the lizard, how big they are. You need to watch out, she doesn't go in the bushes. Our lady. Awesome lizard.
I guess after showing you these animals, we're pretty much at the end of the video. Back me, you see the setups. They're pretty simple. Water bowl, substrate, a hide. These animals don't need that much. So they're pretty easy lizards to take care of. But of course, these are venomous lizards. And we can't forget that these are venomous lizards. And the bite will hurt a lot and cause some serious trouble. So let's not forget, these are venomous animals. It isn't just for anyone. You want to have at least some experience with bigger lizards. And also lizards that, are not always the calmest. Let's put it like that. But yeah, thank you so very much for watching. I want to thank Jesper. I was able to film these and some of his other videos. We had a really fun time. This is my last day shooting videos here in Denmark. For now, I'm just going to chill, go back home and edit and upload all these videos. I want to say thank you to everyone for subscribing. Also to all the new subscribers. I hope you liked the video. If you did, then like it and whatever people ask for. I know sometimes because I'm too busy, I don't post a video. I try to do it at least once a week, but it doesn't always work out like that. I have other priorities. So if you want to keep like more up to date of the stuff I do and the things that are coming in the future when it comes to videos and content, then follow me on Instagram. I will try to put a little bit more content on there because it's easy and it's fast. So you still get an idea of all the stuff we're doing and that's coming. But in case you miss a video, at least you know, what's going on. So if you like to know that, feel free to go to our Instagram page at the Rarum Channel. Find us there, follow us, and I'll see you on the next episode. Thank you very much. Bye.